welcome to another edition of UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Director for the Humanities at the University of the District of Columbia Community College, and your host. Joining me for her second appearance on UDC Forum is Dr. Karsonya Whitehead, Professor of Communication and African and African American Studies in the Department of Communications at Loyola University, Maryland, and the founding executive director of the Emilie Francis Davis Center for Education, Research, and Culture. She is author of three books, Notes from a Colored Girl, The Civil War Pocket Diaries of Emilie Francis Davis, which received both the 2015 Darlene Clark Hine Book Award from the Organization of American Historians and the 2014 Letitia Woods Brown Book Award from the Association of Black Women Historians. Letters to My Black Sons, Raising Boys in a Post-Racial America, and Sparking the Genius, the Carter G. Woodson Lecture. In addition, Dr. Whitehead is the co-editor of Rethinking Emilie Francis Davis, Lesson Plans for Teaching Her Civil War Pocket Diaries. She is a K-12 master teacher in African American history, an award-winning curriculum writer, lesson plan developer, Baltimore City Middle School teacher, Maryland History Teacher of the Year Award winner, and a three-time New York Emmy-nominated documentary filmmaker. Our topic is twofold: digital communication and social activism, and strategies in the classroom for advancing higher education and media scholarship. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
One of the things that's been one of the most renowned things that's happened is the technology and how that has played a part not only in the social activism but in the arena of academia as well. How are you combining those two?
Well, I think technology, as I often say, is a game changer. That prior to social media, we had different ways of communicating with our students. I'm talking about the old-fashioned ways, where they would either leave a note in your door, and then we advance to email, right, which is, you know, which is, today's students see that as snail mail, yeah, right? They don't even like email. It takes too long for email. Well, social media is now being drawn into the classroom, and I think that as professors, you have to make a choice. Are you going to fight with the technology, and you're going to police the students on their phones and try to shut off all the communication, or are you going to welcome the technology and find ways to integrate that into your classroom? Well, I teach communication, so I don't fight with the technology. I bring it in the classroom. So my students are doing oral histories, and they're going out and hitting the streets. They are documenting their life stories. They're becoming Twitter historians. We're combining history with Twitter, where you're documenting your life in the moment. They did a project on Harriet Tubman where they pretended that they were on the Underground Railroad and they were tweeting their way to freedom by studying and researching the life of Harriet Tubman and then developing tweets as if Harriet Tubman was coming. And if she was coming, what would you say? What would you do? Where would you go? We've had them do stories with Nat Turner where they looked at the life of Nat Turner and said, okay, so if you were going from plantation to plantation with Nat Turner and your job was to be in charge of communication, what would you tell people? How would you get them ready? And I think that's a fun way to bring history and communication together. Will you use that? So I don't fight with technology. I invite it in, and I tell the students, even when I'm speaking at schools, I say, I'm going to do something that you never hear from a speaker. Turn your cell phones on. And I want you to live tweet in the moment what I'm talking about. If I'm saying something that sparks something in you, tweet it out there. If there's a picture you want to take, take the picture. Bring that into the classroom. Bring that into the auditorium, because our conversation should go beyond the four walls.
How do you relate that to the historical piece and the academic piece? What is it that you want them to learn in a classroom that's going out beyond the walls?
Well, this notion that our history goes beyond us, that history is living, history is always changing, that the historical narrative is always being reshaped. And the important thing that you must learn how to do is how to tell the story. Why do we know so little about some parts of African-American history? Because somebody out there is reshaping the story. Mm-hmm. That we have to be trained on how to research our history, how to tell and document our history to make sure that we're properly teaching our history. Technology is the way to do that, because technology is forever. And so all those articles about African-Americans where our lives started with slavery, well, we have to counter those narratives with new stories, with the true history of who we are as people in this country.
What do you say to young people in your classroom if they say that there is no history now, or I don't know about history, I don't like history, or we're not doing history?
Well, first I said, well, where's your phone? Because if you don't think there's any history there, then give me your phone. I said, because if you have a phone, a smartphone as they call it, then you have Google on your phone. Just type in the words African American and see what comes up. There's so much history that's out there. And I'm not saying all the history is correct. Like, I'm not drawing a correlation between the right and true history, mm-hmm. and history as just this wastebasket that we dump everything into. Like, there is a difference. You have to search for the true historical narrative, but it does exist. That's why we're working so hard to digitize primary sources. We understand that paper is on its way out. And so for things like Emily Davis's diary to remain as a part of our historical narrative, then we got to put that into some type of electronic form so that it can be made. I mean, I think about this because my book, Letters to My Black Sons, is based upon 14 years worth of letters that I've been writing my sons since they were in my womb. And so I documented every single aspect of their life, and we pulled out 25 of them for the book, but now I'm really considering having to digitize these, mm-hmm. because in years to come, I want these letters to remain. I want my grandsons and granddaughters to read them, and I want their grandsons and granddaughters to read them. Well, if I want that to happen, I need to find a place, probably on my blog, where I am uploading these sources so it can remain. I think technology might outlive us all.
How is technology reshaping, or is it reshaping, the social activism in this country, especially the young people who have taken on hashtag Black Lives Matter?
Technology has totally changed the way that we do activism in this country. I'm thinking, and I draw parallels between the Civil Rights Movement and Black Lives Matter. Because those are two ready-made movements that people can really look at and begin to document. And I know it's a little bit unfair, because I like to be transparent about this, it's a little bit unfair to kind of really judge Black Lives Matter. It's only, what, 2.5, 3 years old? Mm. Like, it's kind of unfair to say it's a success or a failure. We don't know. I mean, we're still really unraveling and wrestling with the Civil Rights Movement. So we do need a little time away from it. But just for the sake of argument, let's just kind of compare them. And so I have my students begin to look at both of these movements and talk about the ways in which the Black church, then the Civil Rights Movement, was a center of activism. If you wanted to know what was happening, where the march was taking place, who was in town, you went to the Black church. Metropolitan if you were in Memphis, right? You went to Metropolitan AME if you were in D.C. You went to Shiloh if you were in D.C. Right. You went to Mother Bethel if you were in Philadelphia. You went to those Black churches that were centers for activism. And you caught into what was going on. You caught the wave. That King was coming to town, or there was a march taking place, or the March on Washington was happening. But the church was that place where you organized. It was word by word, mouth by mouth, phone call by phone call, flyer by flyer. And they still received 250,000 people at the March on Washington, right? And I'm saying plus. It was a lot more than that. There's no official count. Well, today, if there's a march, I don't have to call anybody. I could just tweet it out. And one person can tweet it out, and before you know it, I can show up somewhere in a flash mob, and I can have 400, 500 people just from the power of tweets, right? So how do we know what's happening in Ethiopia on the ground? How do we know what's happening when Tibetan monks say Black Lives Matter? It's because of the power of social media. Social media has made the world into a village. I mean, we used to be this huge planet, right? Dr. King talked about technology when he gave a speech at Oberlin College, when he talked about being awake during the Great Revolution. And he said in this speech that with this notion of technology, and he didn't even know social media, he was talking about technology with the phones and everything, right, and faxes, but that the world was becoming much smaller. So you fast forward from when King said that till today, the world is a village. I mean, it's a block long, right? So I can know what's happening in real time in Ferguson. I mean, when Ferguson exploded, we knew in real time what was happening because somebody was tweeting it out, somebody was posting it on Facebook, somebody was taking pictures on Instagram and Snapchat, real-time activism. When Baltimore had its uprising, people were following it in real time because I was on the ground, I was sending out tweets, I was posting pictures. This is what's happening at this moment. That has changed activism. I don't have to wait for the newspaper tomorrow to cover the story. And if the story got in too late, they may have it on the back page. I don't have to find out like that. I mean, if Dr. King was alive, instead of putting kids on the front page of the newspaper, you just put it in a tweet. And you do it one time and you send that tweet out and it will reach the world. And that's the power of social media. That's also kind of the downfall, right? Mm-hmm. So you put something out there that you didn't check the facts on it, it's out there forever. I thought it was very interesting when we look at technology. A great example is to look at what happened after the Boston Massacre, after the bomb blew up at the Boston Marathon. One of the things that we were told later when we studied this is that they shut down the internet in this area. So people couldn't make phone calls, they couldn't get online, because what the police officers wanted to do was kind of control the narrative because they were going on a manhunt, which I understand. But think of what that means to shut down technology, to turn off the ability to communicate with the world. Like, it was a black hole over that area. You did not know what was going on. And it was frightening because you had all this news coming out and you don't know what was true and what wasn't true. And I think that technology should be teaching us, and I say should be, I don't know if it is or not, but it should be teaching us about being more responsible, about checking our facts. It's like when I tell my sons to go do their research papers, I'm like, we've got to go to the library. Like, you need primary sources. I mean, you're just going to Google the question, and you don't know who's behind Google giving you the answer to the questions that you're seeking. You have to get reliable sources. So research hasn't changed. Reconstructing historical narratives, that hasn't changed. It's just the ways we've gone about doing it. That is what has changed.
What do you see with Black Lives Matters in terms of the leadership of young people? Are there is there a concerted, recognizable leadership, or is it like Ella Baker said, strong people don't need strong leaders?
Well, I think that's probably one of the differences with the civil rights movement. And I think it's about the controlling of the narrative. Because if you ask people during the civil rights movement, and I've talked to a few of our elders who were active in that time, and you ask them about the leaders, they say we were all leaders. That the March on Washington got started and King had to run, get in front of it, because we were already starting moving. And you think about what happened with the Birmingham campaign, King was in jail. Dick Gregory was in jail. And it was high school and middle school and elementary school students who got locked up. I mean, if people go watch the children's campaign, they'll see who the real leaders were. That Diane Nash, you don't talk about Diane Nash. You don't talk about Bayard Rustin. These are people who actually worked for the movement. So they were, it was leaderful in the civil rights movement, but the narrative constructed by the media, it was just Dr. King, and it was just, you know, a few people, it was just Julian Bond, it was just Andrew Young, it was just Stokely Carter, it was just John Lewis. It wasn't just the five or six of them. Because in that five or six narrative, you're forgetting Dorothy Eyhite, for example, and the work she did with the National Council of Negro Women. Like, you forget all of this, because that's not part of the narrative being constructed by the media. With technology, with the notion of citizen journalist, I don't have to have the media construct my narrative. I can construct my own narrative. I can do Black Lives Matter at Ms. U, where they're doing hunger strikes, and they're working to get the president to resign. I can do Black Lives Matter in Ferguson. I can do Black Lives Matter in Baltimore, all at the same time, not waiting for the leader to show up and start it. We can start it on the ground. I mean, think of what happened just recently in Salt Lake City, right? That was a day before, you know, the Oscars, where you had a young male being shot because he was holding a broomstick. Well, that Black Lives Matter started then. People immediately responded. They didn't wait for someone to get off a plane. They didn't call someone and say, hey, where's Dr. King? Can he show up over here? No. People felt that they had the amount of agency that they needed to stand up and say, this is wrong, to speak in the moment. And to me, that is probably one of the best things about Black Lives Matter. You are not waiting for a leader. You can be the leader. You can start the Black Lives Matter movement right where you are. You can organize a walkout at your school, like the students did in Howard County, in response to a video that a student made talking about how he was not upset about people, black people being killed with impunity. You can stage that walkout. You can do it. You're 16, you're 15, you're 14, you're 25, you're 37. You can be the leader that we need at that moment. And that's exciting. Strong leaders are not needed, because strong people can do the work of leadership and keep us moving forward.
You talked about the responsibility of using social media in activism, because if it's not accurately research and document it, you have information out there. There's also that other side that's tweeting and posting that the hateful, the evil, the ugly, the racists that are out there.
And what I think is amazing, because with my book, with Letters to My Black Sons, the second part of it is Raising Boys in a Post-Racial America. Because there was this idea that after President Barack Obama was inaugurated in 2008, that this notion was, we are now post-racial. Look what we've done. We have elected a black president. We have evolved. We have overcome. I mean, when they asked Dr. King, I believe in 63, you know, did he ever think we would have a black president in America? He said, oh, 100 years at least. Well, that was, what, 54 years or so that we were able to get there? So we had overcome, and we felt very proud of ourselves as Americans that we put a black man into the White House. I think President Obama's inauguration, his election, was a trigger. And with that trigger, what was released into this country was a wave of hatred and anger and frustration and racism that had been held back before then. And technology gave people the outlet that they needed. I can get on the internet, I can remain anonymous, I can sit beside you and work all day and really, really have a hate for black people. And I can smile in your face and I can go home and look to destroy you on technology because you'll never know that it's me. I mean, technology has pulled that Band-Aid off and it has revealed the sore, the pestering sore that is racism in this country. And so in so many ways, I believe that we're all doctors, right? And to heal something, you don't just bandage it up. I know when I go to the doctor, they want me to uncover the Band-Aid. Let me see the wound. Let me see if the wound is healing. And I think we have this wound called racism. And I think this wound has been here since we had the initiation of American enslavement in this country. That is how old that wound has been. It has been leaking and festering and rotting since then. And I think with the election of Barack Obama, it has pulled the Band-Aid off. And it has reminded us that this wound has not healed because we have not dealt with it. You can't just leave it alone. Some wounds need to be tended to. You got to use peroxide. You got to clean it. You got to keep it together. Some wounds have to be tended to. And this wound of racism has to be tended to. And Black Lives Matter is forcing us to tend to this wound. Because Black Lives Matter has come up against this notion of White Lives Matter. Right? I mean, they're calling it All Lives Matter, but this notion of White Lives Matter saying, we don't want to talk about what's happening to you because this is what's most important. You should be happy with what you have, rather than saying we demand to no longer sit on the floor. I think of the story of the Bible where you know, Jesus was saying, you know, should I take the food off the plate and give it to the dogs? And the woman said, you know, well, you know, even the dogs can eat the crumbs, right? Well, I think that we're in this age now. What we are saying is marginalized people, we are no longer going to sit on the floor and wait for the crumbs to drop. We're going to upend the table, and we want to construct a new table where everybody can sit down. And I think that's what's happened now. You have these two forces pushing up against each other, and in the end, one of them, only one, will survive. I think white supremacy is on its way out, and we have to keep forcing it to the edge of the plank until it finally tips over.
Your magnificent presentation at the Association for the Study of African Life and History annual luncheon was directed somewhat toward that, as well as you lifted up Black Lives Matter and talked about the accomplishments and what it has done and the fact that it needs room to grow and before we start judging it. At the same time, you are so eloquently speaking to this festering sore. They're on a collision course.
They are on a collision course. Speaking at Asala, at Carter G. Woodson's, his organization, and giving the keynote at the Black History Month luncheon was probably one of the highlights of my life. I mean, I know about Asala. I mean, they've been around for 101 years. So I know about what it means to be in a room with people who are absolutely committed to the preservation of African-American life and history. I mean, committed to the point that they will not let this die. They will not let the journal die. They will not let the Black History Bulletin die, because they know that if Asala does not teach the world about black history, then the world will never know. Exactly. So that was one of the highlights of my career. And it has just been such an exciting ride since then to be actively involved in wanting to spread this message. I mean, I often laugh and say that when I was growing up, I wanted to be a singer like Whitney Houston. I mean, that was my dream. And then I realized I couldn't sing. I found out the hard way that just because you can sing in the shower doesn't mean you can sing on the stage, right? But I do have this song. And this song is about Black Lives Matter. And this song is about helping people to recognize that my work to pour love and hope and light and truth into the hearts and minds of my boys, that it does matter. That I have the same dream that all mothers have, and that's around the planet, that my children will be safe, that my children can grow up, that my children can find their way and really speak into this dark and lost world. And so I have to sing this song of Black Lives Matter, and I have to sing it until the whole world hears. Because if we don't sing this song, If we don't teach the world about Black history, then the world will never know.
And the use of technology is certainly one of the best tools to do that. And I'm thinking when you're talking about the mothers having the same desires for their children, the way that's been connected many times is when people are tweeting, when they're on Facebook, when they're on the technology, and you have a mother in China, and you have a mother in Africa, and you have a mother in Istanbul, you have people all over the world now able to form groups and connect who've lost children, who've lost loved ones in political unrest, in senseless killings and injustices around the world. You talked about the black hole that happens when you have a whole country that can't get on and it's not allowed. You understand the power of that social media. Talk a little bit about the governmental aspect of that.
Well, this notion that technology is powerful. I mean, I'm very, very happy that we live in a country where the government does not, at least actively, try to control the World Wide Web. We know that Big Brother and Big Sister, they're always watching. We know that, right? That if we talk about conspiracy theories, we understand that if the government wanted to find you, you have a tracking device. You call it a phone. And it goes with you everywhere. Yeah. I mean, we are so connected to our phones that I am probably, like many people, if I don't have my phone with me, I believe the world's going to blow up that day. Like, I really do believe that because I don't have my phone. If I have my phone, the world's going to be safe. But if I don't have my phone, I can really chart the number of blocks I have to go before I'll turn around. Like, if I'm 5 minutes away, will I turn around? If I'm 20 minutes away, will I? And it depends. Like, it really depends. I've been known half hour away. If I'm trying to travel, I need to go and get my phone because how can I get on a plane? I don't have my phone, right? So we are connected to this. There used to be a time we would talk about not wanting to have the government in our living room, at our kitchen table. Well, I think those days are gone. And people will talk to me, oh, I'm not on Facebook because I don't want people knowing about my life. I'm like, do you have a phone? Because if you do, then every time you walk past something, you're checking in. Every time you make a phone call, I said, you need to watch Law & Order SVU. Like, if you want to see, I mean, how your phone could be used as a device to track your every movement, right? So our government does not control our access to the phone. I think it's interesting that's the dark side of it. Mm. Our whole lives are exposed, completely exposed. Now, it doesn't matter whether you're doing something illegal or not. Like, take that out of it. But your whole life is being documented. Does that make you uncomfortable? Every conversation, you know, every place you go, every picture you take, your whole life is being documented and being cataloged somewhere with, I would say, your permission. People are like, oh, I didn't get permission. Did you buy the phone? Did you sign up for the service? Because in so many ways, you gave that permission. I think that we're in the midst of trying to really figure that out, particularly what's happening with Apple. Should the government be allowed to bypass firewalls and tap into someone's phone? Like, that's a huge case. And it's interesting watching the government, I'm saying the government, you know, is, you know, big, huge, not one person, but kind of ramrod their way through this, because that's gonna dictate a lot. I mean, if you actually open up back doors, who else is coming in? I don't know. I mean, I have people say, well, I'm not doing anything illegal, so it doesn't matter. Well, I don't know. I don't know how much of my life should be open for someone else to pick through and determine whether or not they think I'm doing something wrong. There's a part of me that feels uncomfortable about that. And I say that given the fact that I have, and I'll be honest, I have a Facebook fan page, I have a Facebook page, I have a LinkedIn page, I have an Instagram account, you know, I am an avid tweeter, I have a blog. I mean, that's six forms of social media that, as my mom said, if I want to find out where you are, I can go right online. I can find out where you are at the exact moment. Right. So I know that I am adding to the problem by actively participating in the same system that can be used to kind of figure out every movement that I'm making.
And I think that's maybe an intergenerational problem that we may have, but the millennials and our children, as you say, since they're digital natives, use it. Our son is at the University of Missouri. So instantly, when Ferguson happened, we were able to connect, and that's the other part of it. I remember when we were in some marches and our parents didn't know we were okay until we got to a phone. Now we can know instantly, but we can also know instantly if something is going awry there as well.
Yeah, and we can actively respond. I know that when the boys and I, my sons and I, were dealing and being involved in the uprising, that it was important to my husband that we touch bases. And then there was a point on that Saturday night when things really exploded down at the harbor, at the stadium, when I got that email, text. I think he sent me an email, a text, a tweet, and he said, you need to get out of there. Like, you need to get the boys. And get, now you can stay, but get my boys out of there. He said, because, you know, from what I'm seeing here on social media, things are going in the opposite direction. Like, it's about a safety issue now. And I think that's the other side of social media. It's also a way of trying to protect yourself. Yeah. Because other people can kind of figure out what's going on. I can't monitor every site, but I had friends who were monitoring every site who could tell me what was happening two blocks from where I was, or right up the street, or down at the stadium right before I got there. So social media can also act as a nice protective arm when you're actively involved in activist work.
And there's also the thought that social media has driven cameras for police officers, because right. The social media can capture and has been responsible for capturing some of these incidents that have happened where we are losing young black men, and seemingly no one knows what happens, but now that's no longer the case. We can document, we can show you some footage, we can show you the video.
Right, and there's a part of that, though, I must say, that makes me a tad bit uncomfortable. Like, I'm glad that it's being documented. Too many black men and women were lynched and killed in darkness. And I don't mean darkness in terms of light and dark.
No.
I mean darkness in terms of, you know, this cloak for information. I do think there's a price to pay. And I talked about this in my Asala speech. I think there's a spiritual price to pay for the fact that we are exposed to so many images of black lives being taken. I think there's something to be said for always having access to another black man being shot in the back, another black boy being kicked in the face, another black girl in a bikini being dragged down with, you know, the foot of a white cop on her back, another black woman being dragged out of a store by her hair. There's something to be paid for the cost of seeing our bodies being so recklessly used as fodder for somebody else's discussion. I think that's hard. And I worry not so much about myself, because I can counter that with such positive images that I have seen in studying the civil rights movement and reading the speeches. I think about young people who don't know our history. And so that's all you see. All you see is the black body being shot and killed, beaten, stabbed, pushed down, neck broken, spine smashed. That's all you see. That there's something to be said for that. And I think that we have to eventually deal with the healing from us being exposed to these images.
There's certainly more work to be done, Dr. Whitehead, and I look forward to you writing about that, helping with that healing process. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much.
If you would like to know more about Dr. Karsonya Whitehead, visit her website at kwisewhitehead.com. If you would like more information about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website at www.udc.edu. If you would like to learn more about the many certificate and training programs offered by the University of the District of Columbia Community College, visit the website at www.cc.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.